Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Alex Pollock of AEI. It's my pleasure to welcome you here on July 21st, the unhappy fifth birthday of the Dodd-Frank Act, to our conference on what should be done to reform it. A 100% predictable feature of financial cycles is that after a crisis, there is a political and regulatory overreaction, always. So with the Dodd-Frank Act, which, as you know, engendered a truly remarkable efflorescence of growth-constricting regulatory bureaucracy and deadweight cost, along with anti-democratic grants of unchecked and unbalanced authority to bureaucrats, all the while, of course, utterly failing to address the government's own housing finance blunders, which were so important. Are we stuck in the bureaucratic mire of this act forever? Or can we fix it? And if so, how? In particular, you're about to hear how from our expert panel. Let me introduce them in the order in which they'll speak. And as we proceed through the panel, we'll be approximately working our way through the various titles of Dodd-Frank. First will be my colleague, Peter Wallison, who is the Arthur F. Burns Chaired Fellow at AEI. Peter co-directs AEI's program on financial policy studies, was co-chair of the Pew Financial Reform Task Force, and served on the Financial Crisis Inquiry Commission, where he wrote a very enlightening and highly controversial dissent. Previously, Peter was White House counsel to President Reagan, general counsel of the Treasury Department, and practiced banking and corporate law at Gibson, Dunn, and Crutcher. Financial crisis was spawned by the financial crisis spawned Dodd-Frank, but do you understand what spawned the financial crisis? Buy Peter's book, Hidden in Plain Sight, in case you haven't yet. Our second speaker will be Chris Iacovella, Senior Director of Global Government Affairs Strategy and Public Policy at Bloomberg, where he covers policy issues in Europe, Asia, and the U.S., equity, fixed income, and derivatives markets, and the impact of capital, or the lack thereof, I assume, on market structure. Chris was special counsel and policy advisor at the Commodity Futures Trading Commission, including the time of the implementation of Title VII of Dodd-Frank. He's also worked for the House Committee on Financial Services and its Subcommittee on Capital Markets and Government-Sponsored Enterprises. Next will be J.W. Verrett, who is Assistant Professor of Law at George Mason University, a senior scholar at the Mercatus Center Working Group on Financial Markets, and also directs the Corporate Federalism Initiative. Previously, J.W. was on the staff of the Financial Services Committee and was Skadden Arps in Washington, D.C. He's written extensively on corporate law, with his academic work appearing in the Yale Journal on Regulation, the Delaware Journal of Corporate Law, University of Pennsylvania Journal of Business Law, and other journals. Our concluding panelist will be Mark Calabria, the Director of Financial Regulation Studies at the Cato Institute. Previously, Mark spent 7 years on the staff of the Senate Banking Committee, where he drafted significant portions of the Housing and Economic Recovery Act of 2008. That's the act that established a new regulatory regime for Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac, just in time to put them into conservatorship. Mark also worked at the Department of Housing, Harvard's Joint Center for Housing Studies, the National Association of Home Builders, and the National Association of Realtors, as well as the Census Bureau. As you can see, he is very experienced in the government housing complex, and therefore well prepared to reform it. Each panelist will speak for from 12 to 15 minutes, after which we'll give them a chance to react to each other's comments or clarify points. After that, we'll open the floor to your questions until about 2:30. At that point, Peter Wallison will introduce our keynote speaker, Chairman Jeb Hensarling of the House Financial Services Committee. So on to our panel, and Peter, you have the floor.
Thank you very much, Alex. I'm going to start with just a little bit of background on the Act and then cover Titles 1 and 2, all in 12 to 15 minutes. Reforming the Dodd-Frank Act will be difficult because most of the public has never heard of it and continues to believe that the financial crisis was caused by insufficient regulation of Wall Street. In reality, the financial crisis was caused by the government's own housing policies, which forced a major reduction in mortgage underwriting standards. By 2008, more than half of all mortgages in the United States, that was 31 million loans, were either subprime or otherwise risky, and of those, 76% were on the books of government agencies, primarily Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac, the two government sponsored enterprises that dominated the mortgage market. That chart, which some of you who are close enough can actually see, gives you a visual representation of what it looked like. Everything on the left, blue, is Fannie and Freddie. Above that is FHA, the Federal Housing Administration, and then just above that are other agencies also doing the same thing, the VA and some of the agricultural credit agencies also make loans. And on the right, the black, is the private sector's contribution, which is about 24%. And we'll get to that in a minute. The remaining 24%, and that's the black on the right, of these mortgages were on the books of the private sector. And when all of these mortgages began to default, that is the ones that Fannie and Freddie made or bought, and the ones that the private sector bought, when all of them began to default in unprecedented numbers. Fannie and Freddie became insolvent, as we know, and many of the financial firms that had bought these mortgages also got into trouble, and some failed. Now, instead of reforming the government's housing policies, which would have seemed to have been the right way to proceed here, the Obama administration sought to punish the private financial sector with the Dodd-Frank Act, which was one of the most restrictive regulatory laws since the New Deal. In effect, the administration and Congress were attacking the symptoms rather than the disease. I don't have time to discuss all the details, but if you have any interest in really understanding why we had a financial crisis, as Alex suggested, it is in my book, which is called Hidden in Plain Sight and was published in January by Encounter Books. The result of all this unnecessary regulation is an historically slow recovery from the recession that followed the financial crisis, and we can see the slow recovery here. Again, if you can see it from where you're sitting, you can see that the red line, which is the recovery from the 2009 recession that followed the financial crisis, is a real outlier in terms of all of the other recoveries from financial crises we have had before. Now, why would this be? Supporters of the administration's policies argue that slow recoveries generally follow financial crises. But recent academic work has disproved this. Two respected academics recently looked at all 27 recessions the U.S. has encountered since the 1800s and found that those that followed financial crises actually recovered faster than those that were originated for other causes. There were three exceptions to this rule: the Great Depression, the period from 1989 to 1991 when the S&L industry collapsed, and the most recent period, which of course followed the Great financial crisis. These three periods had much in common, and we ought to study them carefully. They were all periods when the government adopted many new regulations and controls over the economy. Those in the New Deal are, of course, legendary, as is the seemingly endless depression they produced. Those in 1989 to 1991 included two major regulatory laws, the Financial Institutions Reform, Recovery, and Enforcement Act, known to us aficionados as FIREA, and the FDIC Improvement Act, known as FDICA. And now we have the granddaddy of them all, the Dodd-Frank Act. Now, this history, to me, strongly suggests that the Dodd-Frank Act is responsible for the slow recovery from the 2009 recession, just like its predecessors. Moreover, because of the huge costs that it has imposed on the financial system, it's likely that the Dodd-Frank Act wet blanket will stifle economic growth in this country for many years to come. Unfortunately, Dodd-Frank seems to have become something of an icon for progressives led by Elizabeth Warren. They will not agree to any changes, even small ones. Now, most lawmakers have heard enough from their constituents to know that the act has been destructive and impeded economic growth. But Democrats are very reluctant to support any changes for fear of rousing the progressive base. In today's conference, my colleagues and I here on the platform will discuss some of the most problematic provisions of the Dodd-Frank Act. Not all, but the most problematic ones. The Title I authority, for example, of the Financial Stability Oversight Council, which I will call FSOC, and that ability to designate systemically important financial institutions, which most of you, if you follow this, know as SIFIs. The Orderly Liquidation Authority in Title II, the Volcker Rule in Title VI, the regulation of derivatives in Title VII, financial market utilities in Title VIII, enforcement powers for the SEC in Title IX, and the Qualified Residential Mortgage, rating agencies, and the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau in Titles IX and X. But I will start with Titles I and II. Title I gives the FSOC authority to designate certain large non-bank firms as SIFIs. The SIFI idea is based on the notion that all large financial firms are interconnected. You'll hear this all the time. You'll read it in the papers. They're all interconnected. And if one fails, this is the theory, it will drag down others. That's why SIFIs have to be specially regulated by the Fed under Dodd-Frank to reduce their risk of failing. However, we can see from looking at what happened after Lehman Brothers, and this may seem counterintuitive, after Lehman Brothers failed, that this idea is wrong. No other large financial institution failed as a result of Lehman's failure. And this is true even though Lehman was one of the largest non-bank financial firms and a major player in the credit default swap market. And also, its bankruptcy occurred at a time when market participants were very worried about market instability. This shows that large non-bank financial firms are not dangerously interconnected, and if one of them were to fail, it would not drag down others. So there is no need to designate non-bank firms as SIFIs, and no need to save them when they fail. Since designating firms as SIFIs is unnecessary and extends the too-big-to-fail idea to other areas of the economy beyond banking, the FSOC's designation authority should be repealed. Title II of the Act is called the Orderly Liquidation Authority and provides extraordinary power for the FDIC to resolve large failing financial firms, including banks and non-banks. From what I said earlier about Lehman, it should be clear that there is no need for a special system for resolving or rescuing non-banks. They can fail and be resolved in bankruptcy without harm to the rest of the economy. Lehman's bankruptcy caused chaos, to be sure, but that was because it represented the government's complete reversal of a policy of rescuing large firms that market participants thought the government had established with the rescue of Bear Stearns about 6 months earlier. Until the Sunday before Lehman filed for bankruptcy, the Treasury and the Fed thought they had a buyer for the firm. When that fell through, the government had no plan B. It refused to put up the necessary funds, even debtor-in-possession financing, so Lehman's bankruptcy became inevitable. Although Lehman's bankruptcy lawyer was contacted earlier in the preceding week, he was not authorized to draw any papers until late on Sunday, before the filing on Monday morning. Because of this government bungling, any opportunity to keep Lehman operating under Chapter 11 of the bankruptcy laws was lost. Still, while chaos resulted from Lehman's bankruptcy, I want to repeat, no other large financial institution failed. Now, there is one group, however, whose failure could cause a systemic event, and these are the very largest banks, say those in the trillion-dollar category. Because of their role in the payment system, the fact that they hold payrolls and perform other essential services in the financial area, it could be important to keep the largest banks from failing. The FDIC has suggested that it would do this through a process it calls Single Point of Entry, SPOE, and which I will pronounce as SPO. Under its SPO strategy, the FDIC says that it would use its Dodd-Frank powers to take over the holding company of an operating bank and use the resources of the holding company to recapitalize the bank. Thus, the bank would keep operating and would no longer be a danger of creating some sort of systemic default. The idea has attracted a lot of favorable attention, but there's one big problem. As Paul Kupiec, my AEI colleague, and I have showed in a recent paper, it doesn't work for the largest 12 banks, the very ones that might actually be too big to fail. The FDIC may have assumed that if a major bank fails, its holding company would also become insolvent, so the FDIC can then take it over under Dodd-Frank. Unfortunately, none of the holding companies of the largest banks becomes insolvent if its subsidiary bank is wiped out completely, if its investment in the capital of a subsidiary bank is completely wiped out. All of them have other subsidiaries and activities that keep them solvent. And if they're not insolvent, Title II of Dodd-Frank does not authorize the FDIC to take them over. So the FDIC's SPO strategy will not work. Now, this is important because the FDIC will then have to take over a failing bank in the old-fashioned way and resolve it in the only way the agency apparently knows how, and that is by selling it to a healthy bank. The trouble with that is that in an era when people are concerned about too big to fail, that won't work either. It will just make the buyer bank that much bigger. Thus, Dodd-Frank does not do the one thing that its proponents have claimed it would certainly do, and that is eliminate too big to fail for the very largest banks. There is a way to solve this problem. The largest banks can be made virtually fail-safe by loading them with contributions to equity capital from their holding company. That's the best solution to the TBTF problem, too big to fail problem. But to put it into effect, Title II would have to be essentially replaced. Even Elizabeth Warren and President Obama will have to recognize that Dodd-Frank must be amended in this way if it is to accomplish its most important purpose. Thanks very much.
Thanks, Peter. Chris?
Thank you, Alex and Peter, very much for inviting me here today. It's a pleasure and an honor to be here. So I'm going to briefly discuss the Volcker rule and the new derivatives rules, and I want everybody to have the political context because both were highly politicized, getting through Congress and then once they were put into implementation in the agency process. Dodd-Frank directed regulators to make substantial changes to the structure of the capital markets without understanding the consequences of those actions. Some consequences have been good, and some consequences have been bad. Some of the good is that you have risk management procedures that have totally changed the industry and the way that it operates, which I'll go into later. The bad was that Dodd-Frank is micromanaging trading behavior, and that is impacting liquidity. As a result, we no longer have freely functioning capital markets, but what we do have, and I hope to demonstrate this to you today, is a capital market that has been centrally planned by Washington regulators who are terrified of risk. The Volcker Rule was put into place by a third-degree amendment on the Senate floor, and the actual text was negotiated in conference committee. There was no hearing to discuss what this would actually do to our capital markets. The policy, although it might be designed to achieve good, is to prevent banks from using deposits backed by the FDIC and cheap credit from the Fed to finance speculative risk-taking, also known as prop trading. When you hear the term casino gambling mentioned by Washington regulators or the president, this is what they're talking about. But after 950 pages of rulemaking, what we have is a rule that prohibits prop trading in corporate bonds, asset-backed securities, and investments in certain funds, but it permits market making by banks for customer accounts through a myriad of rules. And what we have to ask is, if the policy was designed to stop prop trading, then why are banks still doing it? It's because the Volcker Rule allows prop trading in U.S. Treasuries, agencies, and muni debt. Now, you have to step back and say, is that good for the system? If the idea was to prevent people from using taxpayer funds to trade, then why is it that you can invest in a Detroit municipal bond and not an IBM corporate bond? We should think about that. It's a good question. But the practical impact of the rule goes to the heart of what market making is. And when Washington chooses to micromanage trading decisions, it makes compliance very, very difficult. There's no reliable way to distinguish between trading for customer accounts and trading for a bank's own account. And because of this, any rule that limits prop trading must inevitably limit market making and customer liquidity. The ambiguity of this rule is forcing people to err on the side of caution and pull back. This has led to a reduction in corporate bond inventory and is impacting liquidity. And so much so that BlackRock has come out and said that the corporate bond market is broken. The corporate bond market has decreased 77% since 2007, and that's been aided by the Volcker Rule and other rules put in place by Dodd-Frank. Title VII was the derivatives rule. This, again, was highly politicized in Congress and then when the implementation period occurred. Title VII requires reporting of derivative transactions, clearing of these transactions at derivative clearinghouses, trading on swap execution facilities, which are an entirely new registered entity, and margin on unclear trades. These rules were rushed. They were put through and forced down everybody's throat at five rules a week, just because the only way that you can implement an ideology is to overrun people with all of the policy that's set forth in 200 and 500-page rulemakings. This also led, it also revealed attention that is there to this day, which is that the chairman at the time, Chairman Gensler, wanted to overlay the swaps market in the mindset and the mold of equities. But the staff only understood futures. Equities are a horizontal market with many trading platforms. Futures is a vertical market. So there is a disconnect in the rules, which made it very confusing, which caused over 100 no-action letters to be issued, and basically forced people to pull back from the market when trading first happened in 2012. Now, trading has gone up a little bit from last year and this year, but there still isn't the substantial amount of liquidity that people were hoping for. And what you've seen is a bifurcation of liquidity pools. The euro-dollar swap market, interdealer swap market, is totally bifurcated. Liquidity is in Europe, and you can't find it here. So some of these rules that were put in place were done outside of the APA, like I said, staff letters on the eve before a rule was going to come into implementation were put into place. That totally changes behavior, and it causes compliance officers to stop their traders from doing anything in the marketplace. One of these rules was actually, or one of these policies was actually a good idea. It was called straight-through processing. What that did was, as soon as you execute, the trade flows right through to a clearinghouse and there's no operational risk in the system. It's a good idea, but it should not have been put forth in an email to clearinghouses telling them that they had 60 seconds with which to accept the trade. And then the day before trading goes in place, staff issues guidance on this same topic, which just caused confusion all over the market. So There are ways to follow the APA and have public comment and prepare the public, and not a lot of that was done in this situation. Then there is the CEF rulemaking. That is in any means of interstate commerce. You may have heard this term. Under court law, it means any means of interstate commerce, fax, phone, email, etc. But what the chairman thought it meant was order book trading. But for my boss's amendment at the last hour, we would have just had a CEF with order books. Now, order books have not taken hold in the swap market to this day, even though there was a false narrative that said, oh, just put products out there, we'll trade them, don't worry about it. That hasn't happened. And so what you end up with is we have an RFQ system, which are where a person requests quotes, gets them back, and then executes, and you have an order book. The order book is empty. I commend to you Commissioner Giancarlo's white paper because it goes into a lot of depth on this very topic. So where did that leave the CFTC? Well, there is a provision in there that allows for cross-border regulation of derivatives trading. And the idea was the U.S. will lead and everybody else will follow. Well, that's not true. And Commissioner Giancarlo actually termed it properly when he said we're in a trade war where regulatory details are being used as a weapon of choice. The U.S. actually claimed that we have to extend our rules into the EU and elsewhere because we know best how to regulate, and other regulators will not act in our best interest to prevent risk from flowing back to the United States. Well, I can tell you, I've gone to Europe numerous times over the last 3 years, and each time I go there, they laugh at me, and they say, oh yeah, but wasn't it you guys who imported your mortgage crisis into Europe? So we have to think about these things before we make policy like that, and that interferes with international relations. A couple more things I want to talk about. There's been basis risks that's been created in the swaps market. Basis risk basically is when you have a risk, you want to hedge that total risk. In order to do that, you need a swap product. Or you could use a futures product. But the future could leave you with almost 85% of your risk hedge, and then 15% just sits there, and you absorb that risk. You pass that on to consumers. You pass it on in your prices. Also, it sits there on your balance sheet. So we don't know how much of that is out there, but that is starting to happen. The other thing that the derivative rules did was they really put a hurt on futures commission merchants. They caused prices to go up so much for them that the business became unprofitable. The only people that are offering future commission merchant services now are large banks. It's another thing we have to question and that we can look at later. One good thing that these rules did is they did bring some price discovery through to the marketplace, and there is one product that is trading 93% of the time electronically. That's a CDS index investment grade. So that's very good, but the uptake hasn't been what was sold in Congress or during the implementation period. So where does that leave us? Central bankers took this time to watch and see what happened. The politicians didn't break up the global banks. They just didn't do it. But as time has passed, prudential regulators have become emboldened. They're now using a complex web of trading, capital, margin, liquidity, and leverage rules to discourage risk-taking in the capital markets and to force an end to the global banking model. The global banking model was predicated upon holding companies being able to transfer risk among affiliates and servicing large clients all over the world. Prudential regulators don't like that, and the view is based on this simple fact. They believe that they can contain any risks in their own jurisdiction, and they can't regulate them outside of their borders. So all these rules are designed to create that shift away from global branch banking to fully capitalized individual subsidiaries under a holding company. This results in an internal bifurcation of global trading and collateral functions. It forces a pre-trade transaction analysis, which makes you not just look at a screen and click and then be done with the trade and it goes to the back office, but to think, how am I going to collateralize that trade? Do we have that collateral? How do I source that collateral? What's the cost of it? So this has fundamentally changed the way fixed income desks work. Fixed income and derivatives are inextricably intertwined, so it's reshaping the entire industry. It's good because you understand the cost of the trade and the transaction all the way through, and it's a little bit more risk management discipline. It's also good because you're analyzing your customer relationships and your product offerings, and some product offerings are disappearing, like single name CDSs. But this is bad because you are analyzing your customers, and some of your customers, not the big ones, are being told you don't have access to liquidity anymore. The regulations flowing from Dodd-Frank have also forced market participants to use only U.S. Treasury and agency debt to collateralize their trades. They force banks to hold U.S. debt as capital, and they permit U.S. debt to be prop traded. Why? Why is it that U.S. debt gets the sacrosanct level? I'm not 100% certain, but I think we should question why regulators decided it was necessary to create an artificial demand for U.S. debt. Is it designed to appease the housing industrial complex by creating a permanent spigot of liquidity to prop up the housing market? I don't know, but we should ask. Is it because regulators were directed to create an incentive for market participants to buy our debt because of a political need to continue to finance deficit spending? We should ask. Is it because regulators believe that the U.S. debt is not subject to market forces? It's a question worth asking. Whatever the reason, one thing is clear. The health and stability of our financial system is now dependent on price movements of U.S. debt. And if markets move against U.S. debt, or we have another flash crash that causes foreign investors to reevaluate our treasury markets, we could have a very big problem. And I would commend to you that with an $18 trillion deficit, our debt is hardly risk-free. Going forward, market participants have been incented to take risk in and hold U.S. Treasury and agency debt. This regulatory planned market system is dangerous because it concentrates one form of debt on everyone's balance sheet across the system. And if markets move in an unexpected way, everyone will be holding the same wrong way risk at the same time. Now, that should ring a bell here because that's exactly what happened in 2007 and 2008 with the mortgage products. And I highly doubt that the Fed and Congress will sit by and do nothing. As for the Dodd-Frank rules, capital, margin, and Volcker rules will continue to exacerbate volatility in the fixed income and derivatives markets. The basis risk that I referred to in the derivative markets will only become a concern when prices move against market participants and they cause losses and force selling through margin calls. But one thing is clear to me, margin calls and large price movements will become the new normal because government rules are directing trading decisions in the capital markets and they're decreasing liquidity and other asset classes. The net effect of all of this force change has been a decrease in sustainable liquidity in the U.S. swap, in the corporate bond markets, and now even in our U.S. Treasury markets. Thanks.
Thank you, Chris. You made a lot of points, but I want to comment on one of them. That is, the testimony of financial history is quite clear that governments always promote government debt. And the employees of governments, that is to say regulators, always promote government debt or the sponsored agencies of a government. That, I think it's a big problem. JW.
All right, thanks. I'm going to talk about Title 8 and Title 9 in 15 minutes, which is a challenge because I think they're hundreds of pages long together. Start with Title 8.
The chair is sure you'll meet your challenge.
Yes, Title 8 is a provision that is, I think, probably inspired by some of the central clearing provisions in Title 7. Title 8 provides for the designation of financial market utilities that are deemed to be systemically significant by the FSOC. These financial market utilities or platforms that provide for for settlement, clearing, or payment systems. So a wide variety of types of FMUs covered here, everything from DTCC, which provides a settlement system for the trading of securities, to the clearinghouse's CHIPS program, interbank payment program. Title 8 does two things, essentially. It's said that when God closes a door, he opens a window. So here, the regulators, when they close a door on you through regulation, they open a window. In this case, it's the discount window at the Federal Reserve. So what designated FMU is deemed, once deemed an FMU, becomes designated for a special regulatory regime from either the Federal Reserve or in some cases for the SEC and the CFTC. And FMUs also have automatic access to the Federal Reserve's discount window, which is that sort of access has been heretofore limited to commercial banks. There could have been another way to, I think, run this railroad. I think if Title VII and the rulemakings under Title VII had allowed for more freedom in ownership of clearing and settlement systems, I think that you would have firms more willing to pony up to provide any liquidity needs of these firms. But the way Title VII was implemented there were some, I think, very dangerous restrictions placed on the ability of these entities to the ability of private parties to take an ownership in central clearing entities. I also have some concerns generally about the notion of the Federal Reserve as a regulator, particularly of payment systems, because think about this, okay? The Federal Reserve is the primary regulator of its primary competitor, the chip system run by the Clearinghouse Association. The Federal Reserve is also the primary regulator of the clients of both chips and the Federal Reserve. So the Federal Reserve competes with, is a primary regulator of its competitor, and is the primary regulator of many of the clients of it and of its competitor. I think that Hayek called that central planning. I think that's what he meant when he talked about central planning. I don't think the Federal Reserve manages those conflicts particularly well. And George Selgin is here from Cato. He's written about the fact that we don't need a central bank to really run a wholesale payment system. The private sector can do it pretty well and has done it for a long time, actually, competing with the Fed. And I think on a per-transaction basis, does it much more cheaply than the Federal Reserve. And to see that, just go take a tour of one of the regional Fed banks. They're like palaces. I mean, they're pretty nice places with private cafeterias that are even better than AEIs, if that's possible. And then let me close Title VIII by noting that Peter Wallison, my colleague Hester Peirce and Mercatus, have both written about a dangerous provision tucked away in Title VIII that allows for activity-based designation. And that under their read, which I think is a very reasonable read of that provision in Title VIII, it could allow for potentially unfettered regulation of industries not intended to be regulated directly by Dodd-Frank, like, for instance, credit unions. It could be used as a method to regulate asset managers on an activity-based basis. So I would think very carefully about those provisions in Title VIII. Let me move on to Title IX. Title IX in Dodd-Frank is sort of a grab bag of securities and corporate governance provisions and a number of other things. If you've never been to a kids' party, I've been going to a lot of those recently. At the end, you always get a grab bag, and it's just a bag full of junk. I mean, it's a bag full of items that make no sense to each other. Nobody really knows what to do with them, and I think that's the best description I could give to. Yeah, right. A lot of sweeteners. Yes. In Title IX. So just to run over a couple of them, there are new enforcement powers for the SEC, particularly with respect to civil penalties. I have some concerns about those powers, particularly in the hands of the current enforcement regime at the SEC. Look at the recent stories about what I would call a scandal of a due process scandal at the SEC in terms of moving cases internally to administrative law judges, making the appeals process much more difficult for litigants. By the way, the administrative law judges, not surprisingly, are a forum in which the SEC enjoys a much better win rate. So I have some concerns about those powers in the current regime's hands. Whistleblower award provisions in Title IX that for those companies, and most companies, I think, have internal compliance regimes that want to fix problems as soon as problems are reported. The incentives are instead to go straight to the SEC to get a piece of that reward. I think there are some unintended problems resulting there. And speaking to the corporate governance provisions in Title IX, let me point anyone interested in this to a book that came out around 2000 called Working Capital. And it's a play on words. Working capital is an accounting term, but this was funded by unions to look into how to leverage their pension fund investments in companies to further a social sort of welfare agenda. So it's sort of the working man's capital at work. It has a number of ideas that were included in Title IX. So this is a 10-year-old idea, and they sort of saw a window to implement these, particularly pay ratio disclosures, and they took it. And I think that's evidence enough that Title IX had very little to do with the financial crisis. So in terms of particular corporate governance provisions, we have an advisory vote on the executive compensation. We have disclosure of the ratio of CEO pay to the pay of the average worker. What does that have to do with the financial health of the firm? I don't know. In fact, it's potentially, I think, damaging to the financial health of the firm because it's intended, I think, to discourage firms from metering executive compensation to financial, results. It's intended to implement a social welfare agenda on behalf of the unions. I mean, there's no other way to describe that. I think it's very dangerous. And if you want to have that debate, have it in another forum other than the securities regulatory system, is my view. There's also a proxy access provision in Title IX of Dodd-Frank. This was the first rulemaking the SEC chose to do, and it was quickly defeated in court on the basis of a lack of sincere cost-benefit analysis, which resulted in, I think, a more robust cost-benefit analysis commitment at the SEC. So in that sense, I guess it was good. But generally, I think proxy access is another very dangerous provision. I've done an empirical study of the proxy access rule with my colleague at George Mason, Tom Stratman, in Stanford Law Review, where we look at we do an event study of proxy access implementation and find that it caused billions of dollars in shareholder losses. What's a better way to run a railroad here? What's the alternative? I would suggest that state-based competition in corporate chartering is the alternative. And it's not perfect. A lot of corporate law scholars have suggested that there are problems in the state-based system where states compete for corporate chartering. Delaware has been a dominant player there. Delaware takes a very dim view of the market for corporate control as a disciplining device on agency costs. I don't think Delaware is perfect. I clerked in the Delaware courts, believe me. I mean, the fact that they hired me means Delaware is not perfect. But I think a better way to run a railroad is to get rid of the federal overhang in corporate governance. I think you can make the state-based corporate governance system more competitive if you eliminate things like corporate governance provisions in Title IX, in Sarbanes-Oxley, and I think you have to eliminate the Williams Act as well, which is a constraint on the market for corporate control. I think if you do that, or at a minimum, change those provisions to optional for firms to opt into. And before you tell me that's politically impossible, there are some provisions in Title IX of Dodd-Frank that are optional, like the notion of a mandatory independent chairman. Number two, you recognize the right of firms to provide for mandatory arbitration of shareholder claims, which I think the Federal Arbitration Act already provides, and court interpretations of that act already provide, but the SEC hasn't gotten the memo, and they still refuse to accelerate your registration if you have such a provision. Carlisle found that out recently. But I think you need some federal recognition of that right. And then thirdly, a federal codification of the internal affairs doctrine as a binding constraint on the SEC from using its discretionary regulatory authority to impede innovation in state corporation law. If you do those three things, you get a much more robust state chartering system. And then I think when you combine that with a very exciting world of crowdfunding that is coming pretty soon, and as a free market securities lawyer, I think this is the only exciting thing I've seen in the last 75 years of securities regulation. I think that you need a new way of doing corporate governance, a new way of doing state chartering competition to innovate at the scale and the speed that crowdfunding is going to require. And so I think that these three provisions will sort of encourage the kind of innovation we need to see in corporate governance. And I think crowdfunding is going to be the first forum where we see that happen, if we can do that. And I think the one experiment I would point to in how innovation in corporate law can work if you have the freedom to do it from the federal overlay, there's one very small exception for master limited partnerships that trade, or generally they're energy companies that get a special tax code exemption. The NYSE exempts these publicly traded firms from a couple of the listing requirements, including some board committee requirements. As a result, what we've seen is an incredible amount of heterogeneity in corporate governance structures for master limited partnerships. And one of the trade-offs I think we see is rather than things like fiduciary duty litigation and particular structures for committees, we see a regime in which MLPs just distribute all of their excess capital every quarter to their shareholders. Shareholders don't need participation, corporate democracy. They don't need any of that stuff. They just get their money every quarter. If the MLP needs new money, it has to raise it from the public markets. That's a much more powerful market-based disciplining mechanism. I think the less federal overhang we have, the more innovation we'll see in corporate governance. And I think the MLP is an experiment that shows us why. And then I'll close with one last thing I think we could see. If we had incentives to innovate in corporate governance, which the federal overhang in corporate governance inhibits, I think we could see cities getting involved as well as states. Why not cities? Why not Silicon Valley corporations? I think that the Silicon Valley bar is more motivated than anyone to come up with whatever innovations. I can't even think of them because, you know, That's how innovation works. You can't always predict what innovation will be. But I think the Silicon Valley Bar is probably best equipped to deal with particular needs of those kinds of firms. So I think it could be a very interesting world. It requires a couple of things: codification of a doctrine that's already in the law, just make it a constraint on the SEC; recognition of an arbitration right that's already a right, the SEC just hasn't gotten the memo about the FAA; and then thirdly, a switch to optional for provisions in SOX, Title IX, and with respect to the Williams Act. That's already an approach that some parts of Title IX have taken. So I think it's perfectly reasonable. I think it's exciting. I think in the sort of Uber, Lyft, crowdfunding world, I think we need a modern corporate governance system, and getting rid of the federal overhang will be key there. So,
thanks, JW. Mark. Well, Mark is getting up there. JW, you mentioned the unpredictability of future innovation, of course, but surely the Financial Stability Oversight Council can predict all this innovation and know what to do.
Right, sure. Yes.
Mark.
I got a comment that I think I now have heard a new phrase, free market securities lawyer. Sounds like a contradiction in terms, but hopefully
it's me and Hester. It's the only ones. And Paul.
There's two, hopefully a growing trend. Well, first, let me thank Peter and Alex. I really appreciate the invitation. Was laid out, we're going to be taking different sections. So I'm going to take parts of Title IX that JW did not talk about, and I'm going to talk about Title X. More specifically, I'm going to talk about the credit rating agencies. You think about Moody's, Standard & Poor's, Fitch. I'm going to talk about the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, and then I'm going to end up talking at the end a little bit about the qualified mortgage rule and the qualified residential mortgage rule. Before I start, I would like to, just quickly bat aside what I think is a common straw man I hear, and I'm sure in many other rooms in this town today and across America, you will hear that, skeptics of Dodd-Frank want to go back to bubbles and financial crises. That's ridiculous. I've never met anybody who actually likes financial crises. Certainly, I've seen people who enjoyed them. Quite frankly, I'm not sure I ever saw Barney Frank happier than when they were doing the TARP. But all that said, it's a straw man. The concern really is whether these things work or not. And I think we could hopefully put aside all the straw man spin we're going to hear today. Before I talk about those issues, I do want to associate myself with what has been said by my colleagues. I stated 2 weeks ago before Chairman Hensarling's committee that I do not believe Dodd-Frank has made us safer, nor do I believe it has ended bailouts. It's not just an issue of reducing burdensome, costly regulation. It's also an issue of bringing stability to our financial system. And again, I don't think Dodd-Frank does this. So let me get to the rating agencies. This is actually something where Dodd-Frank tries to go in the right direction. Unlike previous housing booms and busts like the savings and loan crisis, the recent one was particularly tied to our capital markets, and I think it made it much more destructive in the same way, not forgetting, of course, that the savings and loan crisis was expensive. And we did have a recession, and as Peter mentioned, one of the three recessions that took longer than usual was the post-savings and loan crisis. But again, there was something special about this one. And to me, one of the things that was special was securitization and the way that our housing and mortgage markets were linked to our capital markets. And quite frankly, that would have been impossible without Fannie and Freddie, but also impossible without the rating agencies. And so what we witnessed was an outsourcing of due diligence by regulators and investors to the rating agencies. And of course, let me first say that I think the rating agencies provide valuable insights. They certainly have an important role. But I also believe that monitoring works best when it incorporates a diversity of perspectives, that we don't just rely on one particular viewpoint. And so Section 939 of Dodd-Frank gives a nod to this problem. It says you should remove statutory references to the rating agencies. Unfortunately, that removal ended there. Dodd-Frank required, of course, regulators to do a study. I forget the number of studies in Dodd-Frank. Of course, as many of you know, it's almost 400 required rulemakings and almost about 100 studies. Maybe they should have subtitled it the GAO Employment Act. But that aside, what is required from the regulators and the rating agencies is do studies about their reliance on their ratings. There's no requirement for the regulators to reach a certain conclusion. There's no requirement for the regulators to reduce that reliance. And sadly, the regulators have largely chosen to continue that reliance and increase it in many instances. And so that would be not a big deal if most of the reliance on our laws came from statutory rather than regulation, but that's not the case. The vast majority of reliance on rated agencies comes from the decisions of regulators, and Dodd-Frank doesn't change that. So to me, where we have a fig leaf, where we needed a forest. We needed serious reform of the rating agencies. The first thing we needed to do was to prohibit regulators from actually outsourcing their job to the rating agencies. The notion that a bank regulator would go into a bank and look under the hood and say, well, this is AAA rated, my job is done and I end there, to me is just ridiculous. And of course, that's the demand side of rating agencies. The supply side of rating agencies is just as bad. And sadly, Dodd-Frank gets this wrong as well. Whereas we should have ended the current NRSRO system that creates barriers to entry and limits competition, Dodd-Frank actually increases barriers to entry in the rating agencies, such as those found in Section 936. So let me say, I give Dodd-Frank a small, very small amount of credit for recognizing the problem with the rating agencies, but unfortunately, they completely missed the ball on it and fell far short of where they needed to go. An area, however, that Dodd-Frank gets completely wrong, in my opinion, is the role of consumer protection in the crisis and the subsequent creation of the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau. So while, of course, there was fraud, I don't think anybody would deny that. Of course, there was abuse. I think it's more likely the case that asset bubbles generate fraud and abuse more than the other way around. I think it's also important to think about it in this way. Asset bubbles historically come from credit being too cheap, not too expensive. And essentially, the fundamental argument behind the CFPB is that credit was too expensive. And so let me maybe walk you through very quickly what an example would be. If you assume a fixed monthly payment or even expanding monthly payment when you bid for a house, if what the problem was borrowers were having fees and interest rates added on, that means they could only bid less for the same amount of house and stay within the same monthly payment rather than the other way around. So again, if consumers were actually being gouged, that would have pushed housing prices down, not up. So again, I think we need to think critically about that. I also mention the turn in housing prices, the inflection point in housing prices preceded the inflection point in defaults by about a year. So again, the temporal evidence is pretty clear that housing price declines caused the defaults rather than the other way around being the major driver. So again, I would emphasize, we did not see a failure of consumer protection. We saw, as Peter mentioned, a coordinated federal effort to lower underwriting standards across the board. Let me also quickly set aside, I think we can all stipulate that most of the non-bank lenders targeted by the CFPB had nothing to do with the crisis. I don't even think Joe Stiglitz or Paul Krugman argues that payday lenders and auto dealers and debt collectors caused the financial crisis, yet that is who the CFPB is going after. So, you know, you don't see them necessarily going after the real estate industry. You don't see them going after Fannie and Freddie. You see them going after all these unrelated industries that had zero to do with the crisis. That's not to say that those industries may or may not have needed different levels of regulation. But again, what we saw, and JW touched upon this as much to Title IX, most of Dodd-Frank was a bait and switch. It was a, okay, we're going to end bailouts, we're going to protect a system, but don't look why we put all this unrelated stuff in here that has nothing to do with it. Sometimes I hear the argument that we needed to create the CFPB so that banks would have a level playing field with non-banks. Let's first start with the observation that there's not a level playing field anyhow. These small consumer guys like payday lenders, they don't have access to insured guaranteed deposits. They're not going to get bailed out. The argument that poor little Citibank is going to have to compete with Cash America and therefore we need the CFPB to protect it strikes me as ridiculous. So again, let's emphasize a lot of focus on people who had nothing to do with the crisis. I'll also say quickly, to me, one of the more dangerous precedents is the funding mechanism of CFPB. For you, those of you who are not aware, the consumer agency is off budget. It is funded essentially by the earnings of the Federal Reserve. Quite frankly, I think every federal agency should be on budget. I also think this is a direct violation of Article 1, Section 9 of our Constitution that requires appropriations to be done by law. The notion that we would allow an agency to set its own budget and determine its own funding, to me, is really offensive to our good government structures and what Congress was elected to do. This might come as a surprise given our current budget situation, but members of Congress were elected to make hard decisions about spending. A dollar that goes to the CFPB is a dollar that doesn't go to healthcare, education, tax cuts, whatever. The notion that we would put an agency on autopilot. And of course, what is to stop us from, you know, why don't we defund peanut subsidies or defense contracts or NSA, whatever, out of the Federal Reserve budget, and then we have to worry about raising taxes ever again. I've occasionally heard that we need to do this, you know, we need to take CFPB out of the appropriations process to protect it from bank lobbyists. I actually think what this means is they're trying to protect it from Democrat accountability. Every agency gets lobbied. If you don't think that defense contractors are knocking on the door of the Defense Appropriations Committee every day, then I encourage you to go up there sometime. But no way would that provide justification for taking DOD out of the appropriations process. Let me also note, to me, one of the more troubling aspects of CFPB is it's engaged in a massive data collection effort. Quite frankly, in my opinion, that would put NSA to shame. For instance, the CFPB is working towards coverage of almost 90% of credit card accounts. Let me quote that great defender of free speech, Justice William Douglas. Quote, a checking account may well record a citizen's activities, opinions, and beliefs as fully as the transcripts of his phone records. And of course, today's checking accounts are our credit cards and our debit accounts. And of course, the notion that CFPB is not going to look at that data, I will certainly say as an organization that works, that accepts donations from credit cards, the last thing I would want to do, think about is CFPB looking to see who gives to Cato Institute. I certainly think that is troubling. And of course, as Justice Marshall observed, unfortunately, there's been a long trend in this country of using bank examination records to abuse political opponents. So I'd be sad to say that this will not be new if it does happen. Hopefully the CFPB is not listening too closely because I don't want to give them any ideals. But so for those who care about the Fourth Amendment, which I do, and I hope most of us do, and care about protecting consumer privacy, I don't think there's any bigger threat than the CFPB, given that this financial collection also leaves consumers very vulnerable to data security breaches. I assume I'm not alone in the room in being a former federal employee who got a nice couple of letters from OPM about my data being potentially hacked. You know, so to me, the CFPB is unfortunately doing hackers a great service by consolidating all that credit card data in one place. Unfortunately, I think that would, you know, be a very real risk. And of course, GAO has recognized this in some of its audits of the CFPB, that it leaves consumers at risk of having their consumer financial data hacked. So again, to me, Dodd-Frank missed what was an important opportunity to rationalize our flawed consumer finance laws. Instead of those laws, along with new created powers, were transferred to an unaccountable agency whose bureaucrats can force their preferences on consumers. I fear that the agency will do for consumer financial products what has the federal government has done to our mortgage market, which is, Peter, I think, demonstrated, royally screwed it up. Speaking of mortgages, let me spend my last few minutes talking about the qualified mortgage and the qualified residential mortgage rules. So this is something that I think that there's great agreement on. Even if you look at Peter's dissent to the Financial Crisis Inquiry Commission, you look at the other dissents and you look at the majority opinion, there's actually one consistent observation from all the committee members, and that's problems in underwriting in the mortgage market. That's agreed upon. What's not agreed upon is why. So Dodd-Frank does recognize the special role of poor quality mortgages in the crisis. Unfortunately, Dodd-Frank and the regulators in this instance screwed that up too. The qualified mortgage is an extension of the Truth in Lending Act, whereas the qualified residential mortgage rule is an amendment to the 1934 Securities Act. Both contain substantial liability. The qualified mortgage is essentially targeted at helping to generate consumer class actions next time around, whereas the QRM will generate significant investor litigation next time around. I will note with the QM for my friends in the lending industry who thought it was hard to foreclose, this time around, you ain't seen nothing yet. It will be very difficult, if near impossible, to foreclose in the next downturn. The only avenue, of course, for avoiding this liability is to meet the safe harbor provisions in the QM and QRM. One way to meet those safe harbor provisions, of course, is to sell your loans to Fannie, Freddie, or have it insured by FHA. So to me, one of the really twisted ironies of Dodd-Frank is that one of the reasons for the public demand for action and passage was that the American public was asked to bail out the mortgage market. But what do we have today as a result of Dodd-Frank? Over 90% of the mortgage market is directly on the backs of the taxpayer. The taxpayer is more exposed to the mortgage market today than ever in history. So again, these things could have worked out well. I will note that Barney Frank said about a year ago on the last anniversary that he saw the QM and QRM as the most significant parts of Dodd-Frank. The liability was always going to be an issue, but these provisions could have done something to reduce mortgage default. But as the regulators started along that path, they certainly actually started out well, including things like down payment and credit standards. But unfortunately, the regulators caved to pressure, and what ultimately ended up was a gutted QM and QRM that even Barney Frank says was mishandled. So why is that necessarily? So one of the debates around the financial crisis is what exactly mortgage products caused the crisis. Some of my friends in the consumer advocacy world, and proponents of Dodd-Frank will tell you that it was caused by prepayment penalties and low documentation and exploding arms. I would point you to a number of analyses that GAO has done, certainly an objective party in this instance, as well as a number of other empirical studies, and the results are quite clear. The main drivers of default, I guess I should say aside, you could even look at the studies by organizations like Center for Responsible Lending. Their own studies show that the main drivers of default are loan-to-value, borrower credit score. Everything else is literally a rounding error. And so, of course, the final Dodd-Frank QMQR rules essentially abandon the things that actually drive default. And of course, given QM's obstacles to foreclosure and endless servicing requirements, again, making it near impossible to foreclose, my opinion is that the QM rule will actually increase foreclosures next time around rather than decrease them. Of course, because as we know, the harder it is to foreclose, the more people who are willing to go into default. And of course, this is all too consistent with the views of the CFPB. Its mission has nothing to do with financial stability. Its mission is to use our regulatory system as an avenue for redistributing wealth, to force prudent borrowers to subsidize imprudent. We all know the crisis was quite costly. It also, however, provided a cover for massive expansion of government powers. Wrapping up.
One minute.
Okay, I'm not even going to need that. So I would say, and end with saying, if we hope to avoid financial crises, I think we've got to repeal Dodd-Frank apps 100% full route. But I think a repeal is certainly not enough. Our pre-crisis system was broken. It was flawed. And in fact, to me, one of the real flaws of Dodd-Frank is it extends the pre-crisis system. Whether it's the CFPB, whether it's FSOC, the theme of Dodd-Frank is let's expand bank-like regulation to everybody else. So again, think about it that way. The notion of Dodd-Frank is that if only AIG had been as regulated as well as Citibank was regulated, everything would have been fine.
Thank you, Mark. I'm going to let each of the panelists in order add something if he likes, or take up something somebody else said, or reiterate a point, maybe about 2 minutes each or so. Peter?
Thanks. There were a couple of things that occurred to me that we might add a little bit. First of all, I've heard a lot about the costs of swaps, and you didn't cover that as much as we might have covered it. But that, and also the question of hedging under the Volcker rule, that's also a problem. Well, you talked about market making. Market making is a problem. You can't distinguish market making from prop trading very well, but it's also the problem of hedging. A lot of activity that banks engage in is hedging activity, hedging their risks. That also looks a lot like prop trading. So how today, I think, is the day that the Dodd-Frank, the Volcker rule goes into effect. How are banks going to deal with this problem?
Well, they're going to hire a lot of lawyers in this room.
Good. That's always good.
You know, and I think that's the problem here, is that when you layer in so many rules and so many exceptions and ambiguities inside of these rules, and a lot of them are done, and there's a political compromise inside of agencies, and this rule in particular had six different agencies working on it, and each one of them had to get their pound of flesh right at the last minute. And what we have is you will do hedging if you're a bank out of your bank account. But you could also be doing hedging because there is a reasonable anticipatory demand that your customer, who you know holds the same products as you, may also want to hedge. But then you have to explain that transaction and tell people why it's not prop trading. So this is why I think you're going to see pullback and you're going to see flow out of the fixed income corporate markets and into the safe markets, into the markets that are easy to value, easy to collateralize, easy to mark on a daily basis. And when prices move up and down, you don't have a problem because you don't have to deal with that rule. And again, this is very bad for the real economy because corporate treasurers need to hedge. They need these instruments and they need them, and they also need to know that when they issue their debt into the capital markets, that if the debt is not fully subscribed, that the banks will take that debt down and stand behind it to make a market whenever markets move up and they move down. And it's not clear to me that if there's a bankruptcy or if there is an issue with specific debts, and we could have an issue coming very shortly here in the high yield energy and oil and exploration area coming within the next 6 to 8 months, whether banks are going to step in and take on the liabilities that they used to for fear of holding inventory too long or being told that they're not hedging, that that hedge turned out to be a prop trade because the customer's reasonably anticipatory demand vanished. So I agree with you, Peter. This is a very, very, this is micromanagement of the capital markets.
All right, Chris, that took up Peter's time, but now you have another 2 minutes if you want to add something else.
I wanted to agree very much with what Mark said. I was a securitization attorney during the crisis, and what we did, my entire industry was predicated upon taking advantage of rules. It was basically you took advantage of the risk-weighted capital requirements in the banking book and changed that into a AAA-rated security that got less, that you had to hold less capital against and put it in the trading book. And to me, that is, again, that's government interference that created an incentive for people to act and create an asset bubble. And you accurately stated the credit rating agency reform didn't really happen. And I'm not, to me, I think that the capital, the Basel capital risk weighting rules are still a huge problem that haven't been addressed. And I think what you're going to see, because there's a global growth stagnation, all of a sudden the idea is going to be, well, infrastructure bonds in emerging markets, United States infrastructure bonds, all these things should start get better capital treatment. They should be treated more like government debt. And I wonder what your comments are.
Let me say, I fully agree with that. So Basel is out there that has not been fixed. And so, let's keep in mind that, Basel told us that Greek debt was risk-free and you had to have zero capital against it, that Fannie Mae was risk-free. And so while I'd be the first to say that Basel III, in my opinion, is an improvement over Basel II, it's only a small improvement in the same basic framework. Fitz there, I'll also take this as a moment to plug, sort of bipartisanship. We were very, very fortunate in this country that our banks did not adopt Basel II before the crisis, because they would have been even more highly leveraged. And I attribute some amount of credit to Senator Sarbanes and Senator Shelby beating the Fed endlessly upside the head and saying, don't implement this thing, you will end up having less capital, which I'll end with saying gets me to a different theme of, one of the themes of Dodd-Frank is to hand ever more discretionary power to the Federal Reserve, and you talk about a string of regulatory failures.
Scholl's paradox, which is named after my friend Professor Bernie Scholl, is no matter how much the Fed fouls things up and how gigantic its blunders, with each crisis it always gains more power and more authority. And it's historically true, and Dodd-Frank is the last example. JW, further comments?
Sure. I just want to touch on another issue that I see in Dodd-Frank perpetuating a problem that long precedes Dodd-Frank, which is the inclusion of immaterial disclosures in securities disclosures. I mean this to apply to both conflict minerals disclosure and to lease payments disclosure for oil development. Conflict minerals, or minerals developed in the Congo, they finance the bad guys, they finance the good guys, and they finance people completely uninvolved in the war. But Oxfam decided that we should stop purchases of conflict minerals in the West. And so there's a mandatory requirement for disclosure of conflict minerals for firms, not only firms getting the actual hard commodities mined there, but also for firms well down the supply chain who have no idea where the aluminum in their electronic parts came from. So when you convince, I think it's telling when a liberal law ultimately convinces the Washington Post editorial board that it was a bad idea, which they have come out against conflict minerals, I think it's time to revisit the notion altogether of including immaterial disclosures in securities laws, both by legislative fiat and by the SEC's own power. And Republican and Democrat chairmen have both been guilty of this. I think materiality should be a binding constraint on any mandatory SEC disclosure rulemaking. And Business Roundtable versus SEC stands for the proposition the SEC is supposed to do cost-benefit analysis. How is a mandatory immaterial disclosure going to provide any benefit to investors? None. So it, by definition, fails cost-benefit analysis if it's immaterial. We have ways to measure immaterial materiality, the dominant means of which is stock price event studies, methodology that's gotten great in the last 10 years. I think materiality should be a binding constraint in the SEC, the same way it is for litigants trying to sue under the 34 Act. And so that means we need to relook at everything we've done, and going forward, it needs to be a binding constraint. Not only do we excise the bad things in Dodd-Frank, but I think that's important. So.
Good point. And Mark, you have another chance here. Yeah, 2 minutes if you want them.
I might try not to take too much, a little more than that. First, let me comment on, JW mentioned the pay ratio, and I think partly got it right in that it's an attack on executive compensation. Of course, I think many of the labor groups would prefer that you improve the ratio by increasing the income in the middle. I worry about one of the other potentialities is that you can increase that ratio by hiring fewer workers on the left side of the distribution. And so I do really worry that this is going to have a tremendously adverse impact on entry-level jobs, and as somebody who started at a minimum wage job and learned some valuable skills in that, this war on the lower rungs of the job ladder to me can have really substantial negative impacts, and one that I worry about significantly. I want to pick up on, well, let me first also note, number of institutions in the past, you know, long-term capital management, of course, signature trade was the treasury market, and I believe Alex might remember this better. What was it? First Pennsylvania or something in the 80s blew itself up trading treasuries as well. So we have plenty of examples. Also say as an aside, if you go back and look at, remember Maiden Lane 1, which was the bear assets that were transferred to the New York Fed, half of those were Fannie and Freddie securities. So go back and look at the disclosures of the New York Fed site. So absolutely institutions have blown themselves up with treasuries and agency trading.
Why? You know, we could add Orange County to that.
Yes, we
which
could.
Blew itself up on agency securities.
So I want to end with a question for Peter to parse out and to go back to his first chart about the GSE share. As Peter is well aware, Fannie and Freddie at the height were the single largest purchasers of private mortgage label securities. I'll add as an aside, I've done some digging around, too, and found that, for instance, German GSEs, the London's banks, were very large purchasers of U.S. subprime securities, too. So it wasn't just our GSEs. It was European GSEs. And so the question is that included in the number, or is that in the subprime part?
That was included in the number. And they, that, in order to understand the risks that they were taking, you have to include also their purchases of these subprime mortgage-backed securities, and the problem is that they created the market, because in order to comply with the affordable housing goals, they could get credit for the subprime mortgages that were in these private mortgage-backed securities, and so they told Wall Street, deliver these things to us, we're happy to buy them. And that's how we got such a gigantic market in private mortgage-backed securities that were backed by subprime loans.
And that, I agree, is understood by very, very few people.
Unfortunately, now everyone in this room understands.
So we're making progress.
So, yeah, it's doubles or triples.
Thank you for excellent discussion, panel. Now, ladies and gentlemen, it's time when we're going to take your questions. Let me remind you of AEI rules. First, you have to wait for the microphone because we're being recorded. Tell us your name, your affiliation, and then ask your question shortly and briefly. If you forget to keep it short, the chair will remind you. We'll start right here, and then we'll come over and pick up you.
Yeah, thanks for the panelist's presentation. My name is Li Yang. Seems it's lopsided that you are complaining that from Act is no good. The problem is I haven't heard exactly what is bad. You just say they don't accomplish something. The problem they don't accomplish something is because of a system problem. We're too big to fail because DOJ didn't prosecute those. And because SEC chairman have some kind of revolving doors, and all appointee, it just seems reluctant to take actions. So I just wonder if you have any data that will tell you what Dodd-Frank accomplished. I know CFPB didn't do real job because the data is not there. And I think.
So if I could. Go ahead. So let me first make, I think you touch upon a really important observation about too big to fail, which is so much of it relies on the discretionary decisions of government decision makers, whether it's at DOJ, whether it's at the SEC. And so to me, there's nothing inherently too big to fail about a company and its economics, too big to fail by its very nature of political decisions. And of course, when Eric Holder goes before Congress and says that somebody's too big to jail, that reinforces that perception. So on the data point, so again, I would start with data can be suggestive at best. And so I do think during the crisis, we saw suggestive data that the funding advantage for the largest institutions had expanded. And yes, that has contracted, but of course, in my opinion, you would expect that to contract post-crisis. I think what's important to do is compare the funding cost today versus pre-crisis over time. So for instance, people forget that before the crisis, say in 2006, the largest banks actually paid more to borrow than the smallest banks. The funding advantage was completely flipped. And today, the largest banks still, in my opinion, get about 25, 30 basis point advantage. Of course, there could be a number of reasons for that. But to me, the data suggests that too big to fail has not ended.
Yeah, comment, JW, yeah.
Touched on a couple of points that you made. One of them was with respect to enforcement and prosecution and the role that should or could play in the aftermath of the crisis. I worry about the muddling of actual fraudulent culpable action with bad business decisions. I don't think we want to be a nation that prosecutes bad business decisions. And I think a plausible explanation of the crisis is a lot of people just believe Ben Bernanke when he said there's no housing crisis. I mean, I think a lot of the disclosures that have been prosecuted as fraudulent in mortgage-backed securities deals have involved disclosures that mirrored things that Ben Bernanke was saying. So I have trouble seeing that this was a crisis perpetrated with fraud. Of course, where there's instances of fraud or otherwise culpable conduct, certainly we should prosecute it. But I also think with respect to the enforcement issue, another problem is we don't have enough clear doctrine followed by SEC and by DOJ and charging decisions on collective scienter. This is a concept that's developed in laws that actually go to trial. Most of these things settle when you have big financial institutions. But when it actually goes to trial, when you actually develop some case law, there's a good doctrine of collective scienter that I think we should do more work on. Essentially, the idea is when do you attribute bad action by individuals to the corporation? When the board and the CEO decide to do something bad, it's the corporation's fault. When some distant employee in a division overseas does something wrong, that's not necessarily corporate action. And so I think the SEC should do an interpretive release about collective scienter, its policy on collective scienter. That would resolve a lot of the bad actor exemption debates that are going on right now.
Let me pick up on JW's point. When former Fed Chairman Bernanke said that there was no housing crisis when the housing crisis was already started, that was an incredible mistake, but not a crime.
Right.
I had a question here, and then I have a gentleman over here. Wait for the microphone, please.
Hi, Raj Boya, a DC resident. Thank you for this fascinating panel discussion. I understand this is quite complex, given the number of too big to fail banks and amount of regulation and number of agencies with oversight power and number of financial products. My question to you is, if you look at all the advanced countries, which advanced country do you think has come up with reasonable regulations that encourage economic growth, innovative financial products, but at the same time have reasonable tools and measures in place to prevent a financial crisis or effectively manage a potential financial crisis, where you would be like, yeah, I think this is good enough, that would satisfy you. Thank you.
Okay, anybody want to take that? Look around the world. Who do we think has done a good job?
I guess I'll start with maybe the qualification. I'm not sure anybody quite lives up to my standards, but that aside, I think Canada and Switzerland both do a reasonably well job with banking regulation.
Other thoughts?
Go ahead. I would tend to agree with Mark on Switzerland, especially because of the capital requirements that they impose on their banking system. And I also think since the peso crisis in the 90s in Mexico that the Mexican central bank and securities regulators have taken significant steps to shore up the integrity of their financial system and to make sure that they are that system is not susceptible to massive downward price movements in oil.
Peter?
I'd like to just make a comment about the housing systems that others have used, too, because we want to keep the focus on what caused the financial crisis here in the United States, and it was not the inadequacy of regulation of the private sector. It was the policies of the U.S. government. For example, many other countries had large bubbles, as we did, in housing. And when those bubbles collapsed, as we know, in the United States, the results were catastrophic because there were so many subprime and other very risky loans in our housing finance system. As I pointed out, more than a majority, it was actually 56% of all the loans in our housing market were subprime or risky loans. But in other countries, that was not true. And so when their residential mortgage bubbles collapsed, their losses were much smaller. Study by Professor Jaffe from Berkeley has shown that the greatest losses occurred in the UK and were about 3 or 4%, whereas in the United States, the losses for Fannie and Freddie were 13 to 17%, and for some of the private institutions were even higher than that. So that's the point we have to keep focused on here, is that there wasn't really a need to redo our entire regulatory system here. It was a need to redo our housing finance system and understand what went wrong with that.
Hey, Alex, if I could add, because Chris got me thinking about this, you know, the example of Mexico is a fascinating one in that post-peso crisis, Mexican banking system went from about maybe 15% provided by foreign banks to almost 80% or so today. You could joke a little bit and say the Mexican banking system is the Canadian banking system with the extension of Scotiabank and others there. My point being is reform was essentially pushed because the domestic banks failed so badly that you were not going to have banking services unless you opened up the borders. And so you had extensive competition. And I think the benefit is domestic constituencies feel less strongly about bailing out foreign banks. And so I think it's fair to say that Scotiabank is not going to be bailed out by the Mexican government at any point. And so to me, I raise this because I worry that many of our discussions about financial regulation and trade and what we're seeing really is a kind of pulling up of the drawbridge where we don't want European banks here. Or, you know, you hear these talk from the Fed about all the dangers from European banks entering the U.S. and such. I think we should have more foreign competition on U.S. banks is my bottom line point there.
Thank you. Thanks for the question, which stimulated the panel. We're going to take a question here, and this will be our last question for the panel. No? Anybody? Okay, we're going to wrap up the panel, and let's show our appreciation for their excellent comments. Give us half a minute here to get set up for Chairman Hensarling, and then Peter Wallison will be introducing him. Thank you all. We'll keep going just very shortly. Thank you.
This one looks like it's been drunk out of.
We all set? But wait a minute, he's going to speak. So shouldn't the water be there? Oh, okay. All right. I think we are ready to introduce our keynote speaker. You could all take your seats. Jeb Hensarling was first elected to Congress in 2002, representing the 5th District of Texas. An economics student of the incomparable Phil Gramm at Texas A&M, Jeb learned then what Arthur Brooks is saying now. He said, "I didn't know why I was a Republican," he told a reporter, "until I studied economics. I suddenly saw how free market economics provided the maximum good for the maximum number." He came to Congress as a conservative, and no one can say Washington has changed him. "I didn't come to Washington to be loved," he said, "and I haven't been disappointed." Many conservatives will understand that statement. At this important juncture in the history of financial policymaking, we are fortunate to have a financial services chairman who puts principles first, believes in free markets, and is unwilling to solve every problem with more regulation. It's an honor to introduce a great American, an economist, a lawyer, a chairman of the House Financial Services Committee, and a friend, Congressman Jeb Hensarling.
Well, Peter, thank you for your very, very kind words. I believed about half of them. I'm told C-SPAN is filming this live. If so, I think my wife and children are watching back in Dallas, and they probably believed even fewer of them. But nonetheless, thank you for those very kind words. We know that those on the left have been known to occasionally travel into fact-free zones. And for them, occasionally storytelling has replaced truth-telling, but not with my dear friend Peter Wallison. His work on the true causes of the financial meltdown is really a paradigm of scholarship. If you have not read his work, Hidden in Plain Sight, I highly recommend it, and it is required reading to be a member of the House Financial Services Committee. We need more of this solid research done. And so, Peter, thank you for everything that you do, and thank you for helping us on the Financial Services Committee so much. I'm sorry that Arthur Brooks could not be here today. I'm a huge fan of his. I certainly loved the title of his new book, and I was very happy to find a copy on my desk, The Conservative Heart. I assume it was designed to be intentionally ironic, since we know conventional wisdom is that conservatives have no heart and liberals have no brains. So, should that be true, there might be very little Arthur can do to help those on the other side of the political spectrum, but there is much that he has done to change the misperception of conservatives or create or restore a conservative language that speaks to the heart and not just the head. As we all know, the founders were deeply conservative, and yet they spoke a powerful language of personal worth and happiness. It sparked a revolution of equal rights and liberty under the law that is still transforming the world today. Because it's the conservative movement that lays down the foundations for meaningful work and family and community and faith. The institutions that make it possible for every human being to pursue their God-given right to happiness. Now, I'm told this is author's 11th book. Clearly, I am not keeping up. He is writing them much faster than I can read them. But nonetheless, there is the August district work period coming, which is traditionally when I catch up on my reading. I look forward to catching up on his latest work at that time. Again, thank you for inviting me to AEI. I have been long an admirer of the work that has been done here and for your noble purpose. I have already thanked Peter, but other scholars like Alex Pollack, who is here, Paul Kupiak, frequent contributors to the efforts of the majority in the House Financial Services Committee. Their works are very, very admired. And although wearing a different brand, Mr. Calabria, welcome to you as well. Ladies and gentlemen, regrettably, something is changing in America, and not changing for the good. The animal spirits of free enterprise and entrepreneurial risk-taking and dream-chasing that have identified us as a people are now regrettably being tamed. This corresponds not only to the challenging economic times that we continue to see, but to the perceptible loss of freedom in America today. My remarks are focused today on the unhappy results of the Dodd-Frank Act, the so-called Wall Street Reform and Consumer Protection Act, which was signed into law 5 years ago today. No need to be the first one in your neighborhood to throw a celebration. Weighing in at over 2,300 pages, promulgating 400 new administrative rules, it represents simply the most dramatic, sweeping rewrite of our financial laws since the New Deal. At the time, its proponents, including the president, promised that it would lift our economy in too big to fail and promote financial stability. Yet 5 years later, the evidence continues to mount that our society is now less stable, less prosperous, and less free. The financial panic of 2008 clearly caused much anger against financial firms and the bailouts, courtesy of the taxpayer, that they received. Now, the liberal story has been that an alchemy of Wall Street greed, outsized risk, and massive Washington deregulation almost blew up the planet. This, in the liberal narrative, necessitated enormous taxpayer bailouts and a functional occupation of our capital markets by federal regulators, courtesy of Dodd-Frank. Although false, the narrative has permeated the body politic. I am reminded of Churchill's remark, "History will be kind to me, for I intend to write it." To our detriment, we have allowed the left to write the first history of the 2008 financial panic. Thankfully, Peter has written the definitive history of the 2008 financial panic. Other scholars at AEI and other good committed conservatives have followed as well. It is clear now that the financial crisis did not result from deregulation, but instead resulted from dumb regulation. In fact, statistically, total regulatory restrictions on the financial services grew every single year in the decade leading up to the financial crisis, including such landmark laws that were held for stopping abuses, Sarbanes-Oxley, FIREA, FIDICIA, just to name a few. Yet Washington not only failed to prevent the financial crisis, in many ways, it led us into it. Washington promoted moral hazard by encouraging bad loans supported by Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac to meet their affordable housing goals, which were put on steroids. Let's remember that more than 70% of the subprime and Alt-A mortgages that led to the crisis were backed by Fannie, Freddie, the FHA, and other taxpayer-backed programs. Liberals asked them, Fannie and Freddie, let's roll the dice just a little bit more. They did, and the taxpayer lost. We all lost. If you have to point to a root cause of the financial crisis, this was it: government housing policies. Additionally, the Federal Reserve certainly did its indispensable part by maintaining a highly accommodative monetary policy that dramatically lowered interest rates and kept them low for a very long time and inflated a housing bubble. Sound familiar to anyone? Let's now examine another part of the left's narrative of the financial crisis and the claim regarding, quote unquote, outsized risk being taken by financial institutions. As Hayek explained in The Road to Serfdom, the willingness to bear risk is one of the central ideas upon which society rests. Risk is an essential element not only of personal liberty, but of market prosperity as well. To take away risk from the financial system is to take away innovation, to take away opportunity for the common man to succeed. Ladies and gentlemen, if we ever lose our ability to fail in America, we will one day soon lose our ability to succeed. For those who want Washington to be the final arbiter of acceptable financial risk in our economy, they should first consider whether Washington is even competent to manage risk. A review of the federal government's track record in this area does not inspire confidence. The National Flood Insurance Program is $24 billion underwater, and yes, the pun is intended. The Pension Benefit Guaranty Corporation is running a total asset deficit of approximately $62 billion. And fairly recently, the Federal Housing Administration received their first taxpayer bailout courtesy of the Obama administration. Now let's turn to greed. It is an article of faith on the left that it was Wall Street greed that really caused the crisis. My question to them is, when hasn't there been greed on Wall Street? How could that possibly be the determining factor? There's a much greater threat, and that is Washington greed, the greed of the ruling elite for more power over an ever-increasing share of our economy, our lives, and our liberty. And ladies and gentlemen, Dodd-Frank is the absolute epitome of Washington greed. The Dodd-Frank architecture, first of all, has indeed made us less financially stable in many ways. Since the passage of Dodd-Frank, the big banks are bigger, the small banks are fewer. But because Washington can control a handful of large established firms much easier than many small, zealous competitors, this is likely an intended, not an unintended, consequence of the act. Dodd-Frank concentrates greater assets in fewer institutions. It codifies into law too big to fail, and taxpayer-funded bailouts. Title I dangerously allows the federal government to designate too big to fail firms, also known as SIFIs. In turn, Title II creates a taxpayer-funded bailout system known as the Orderly Liquidation Authority that the nonpartisan Congressional Budget Office estimates will cost taxpayers over $20 billion. Now, from Wall Street's point of view, Dodd-Frank may not prove such a bad deal after all. The big investment houses can help shape regulations guaranteeing these taxpayer bailouts for themselves while stifling competition and grabbing even increasing market share. This is bad policy and worse economics. It erodes market discipline and risks further bailouts to be paid mostly by lower and middle income taxpaying families. It becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy, helping make firms bigger and riskier than they otherwise would be. Let's look at two other prime examples of Dodd-Frank risk. First, the derivatives market. They were perceived to be at the heart of the financial crisis. Dodd-Frank's scheme for regulate them is to mandate certain derivatives claimed to be systemic risk to be cleared through centralized clearing houses. It then designates these clearing houses as a whole new class of institutions it calls systemically important financial market utilities, also known as FMUs, since Washington excels at acronyms. In return for greater supervision of the federal by the Federal Reserve, guess what the FMUs receive? Immediate access to the Fed's discount window. Now, you might expect these private firms to resist this type of socialization. A former FDIC chair, Sheila Bair, said some of the clearinghouses, quote, were drooling at the prospect of having access to loans from the Fed when Title VIII was being crafted. So Dodd-Frank did not lessen risk in this regard. It just centralized it and placed it on the taxpayer balance sheet. Next is the Dodd-Frank horror known as the Volcker Rule, a 932-page confounding, confusing, convoluted regulation which hits Main Street businesses right in the heart. The rule is a paradigm for a bureaucratic solution in search of a problem. It severely limits financial institutions' proprietary trading. Of the roughly 450 financial institutions that failed during the 2008 financial crisis, not one was due to proprietary trading. Not one. In fact, financial institutions that varied their revenue streams were better able to weather the storm, keep lending, and support job growth in our economy. While Volcker still searches for a problem that does not exist, it is creating a new problem that didn't exist before, and that is dramatically reduced liquidity in our corporate bond markets. Many economists, in fact, believe the next financial crisis could very well result from the illiquidity and volatility in our bond markets. Recently, some of you may have seen an opinion piece in the Wall Street Journal penned by the CEO of Blackstone, who wrote, quote, "Locked up markets and rapidly falling security prices will force banks to reduce assets and hoard liquidity to satisfy regulatory tests. With individuals suffering losses and companies not able to raise capital, the economy will contract with layoffs, lower tax revenues, and pain for middle and lower income Americans." I agree. Now, in addition to making our economy in many ways less stable, Dodd-Frank has also made us less prosperous. And that's what I will discuss next. Under the Obama economic strategy, of which Dodd-Frank is one of its main pillars, our anemic recovery has created 12.1 million fewer jobs than the average recovery in the post-World War II era. For more than a year now, the share of able-bodied Americans in the labor force has hovered at the lowest level in over a generation. Small business startups are at their lowest level in a generation as well. Had this recovery merely been as strong as the average recovery in the post-war era, middle-income American families would have $12,000 more in income, and 1.6 million more Americans would have escaped the trap of poverty. But more than the numbers, my constituents' angst tells me all I need to know. One recently wrote, quote, "There are part-time jobs around my area, but always jobs with no benefits and less than 40 hours. My son is a disabled Iraqi Freedom Combat veteran who has lost hope of a decent full-time job." Another wrote, quote, "Our small business has recently laid off 25% of its workers. The remaining of us have taken a 15% pay cut, and that's probably not going to be enough without more layoffs for tenured people." Ladies and gentlemen, every member of Congress is still receiving letters just like these. The painful truth is that Dodd-Frank and the hyper-regulated Obama economy are failing low and moderate-income Americans who simply want their fair shot at economic opportunity and financial security. Dodd-Frank has killed off a financial benefit which many, if not most, consumers once took for granted: free checking at their local bank. 75% of banks used to offer free checking, but by 2012, just 2 years into the Dodd-Frank regime, only 39% did so, a trend that many attribute to the price controls embedded in Dodd-Frank's Durbin Amendment. This was brought up in committee just last week, and the Democrats at my committee sneered at this. But for low-income, struggling Americans, the cost of banking is no laughing matter. How does Dodd-Frank's Orwellian name, Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, or CFPB, impact the prosperity of minority borrowers? A recent Federal Reserve report states that within a few years, roughly one-third of all Blacks and Hispanic borrowers may find themselves disqualified from obtaining a mortgage to buy a home simply because of the CFPB's qualified mortgage rule based solely on its rigid debt-to-income requirements. One size fits all. Furthermore, according to the FDIC, more than 9 million households don't have a checking or savings account, principally because account fees are too high or too unpredictable, yet another consequence of Dodd-Frank. The Act's 2,300 pages launched a salvo of consequences that have crippled growth. It supposedly was aimed at Wall Street, but it has hit Main Street. And it has had pernicious effects on small businesses and community financial institutions, which are the lifeblood of the Main Street economy in America. Community banks and credit unions supply the bulk of small business and agricultural loans, but the combined weight of Dodd-Frank's 400 new regulations is dragging them down. In fact, we are now losing one community financial institution a day in America. One Texas community banker wrote me, quote, "My major risk is not credit risk, risk of theft, risk of some robber coming in with a gun in my office. My number one risk is federal regulatory risk." And Dodd-Frank's rules go far beyond our banks and credit unions. The corporate governance provisions of Title IX hit every public company in America. Grocery stores, cable TV servers, bowling alley chains. They didn't cause the financial meltdown, but still they must comply with regulations that functionally impose wage control, salary ratios, and private compensation disclosures, all that were written for Wall Street investment firms. Every dollar that a Main Street business has to invest in lawyers and accountants to explain this gibberish is taken out of workers' wages and capital investment. Is it any wonder that our economy is limping along at 2% economic growth, 40% below its historic norm? No wonder low and moderate income Americans lose sleep at night, worrying about their stagnant wages, their smaller bank accounts, and their children's future. Third, and perhaps most ominously, Dodd-Frank has made us less free. We are losing not only our economic freedom, we are losing our political freedom as well. Today, Americans are less and less governed by the rule of law and more governed by the discretion of regulators. It is OSHA now, not Congress, that governs over workplace safety. It is the EPA now, not Congress, that governs our air quality. It is HHS now, not Congress, that governs over our health care. And most alarmingly to our economic opportunity and economic liberty, it is now the bureaucratic progeny of Dodd-Frank that rules over our financial markets. John Macy of Yale Law School was most prescient when he noted that, quote, "Laws classically provide people with the rules. Dodd-Frank is not directed at people. It's an outline directed at bureaucrats and instructs them to make still more regulations and to create more bureaucracies." Two of the more worrisome new government entities are the aforementioned CFPB and the Financial Stability Oversight Council, known as FSOC. Both operate largely out of public view, and both are subject to virtually no checks and balances. And both, alarmingly, have been granted sweeping unilateral powers to fundamentally control huge swaths of the U.S. economy. Arguably, it is the CFPB that is the single most powerful and least accountable federal agency in our entire nation's history. The CFPB, or more specifically, its one unelected director, has almost absolute discretionary power to find any consumer product, quote, unfair, or quote, abusive, and thus functionally outlaw it. So when it comes to credit cards, auto loans, mortgages of hardworking taxpayers, the CFPB not only has unbridled power to make them less available and more expensive, but has the power to absolutely take them away. Now let's look at FSOC. FSOC is an amalgamation of regulators heading agencies that either helped cause the financial crisis or were largely negligent in preventing it in the first place, notwithstanding they had the regulatory authority to do so. Dodd-Frank rewards their failures by granting them the most sweeping powers over our capital markets again since the New Deal. Dodd-Frank allows federal regulators to unilaterally define vague statutory terms like, quote, systemic risk, quote, financial stress, and, quote, financial stability. And by defining these terms, FSOC can dictate capital standards, product mix, and lending activities of any major financial firm within our economy. Should firms not bow down to FSOC's will, FSOC is even empowered to break them up. This is nothing short of the functional occupation of the commanding heights of our economy by federal regulators who have now been empowered to be central planners. With the exception of agencies dealing in classified information relating to national security, FSOC may very well be the nation's least transparent federal agency. Better Markets, a Washington organization that consistently advocates for more regulation of our financial system, said, quote, "FSOC's proceedings make the Politburo look open by comparison." The raison d'etre of Dodd-Frank was the risk of the shadow banking system, yet a far greater danger is instead posed by the shadow regulatory system, which operates beyond checks and balances of the three branches of government as enshrined in our Constitution. When our founders set up a system of governance, they included many constitutional protections for our great national economy under the rule of law. They wanted a society of commerce and of trade, of industry, of work, of entrepreneurship, and they dismantled high government barriers to these activities. They had a noble purpose. They wanted all citizens, including those in the old world who were at the bottom of the ladder, the poor, the needy, the oppressed, to rise in this new land of promise. It wasn't arrogance that made America the new land of promise, for they knew there was a contradiction between this land of promise and the millions in bondage, here whose human worth and natural rights were denied. As Lincoln told us later, the founding generation could not find a way to free them at the start, but they did at least boldly proclaim that all human beings are entitled to their God-given rights. They had the foresight to lay down an open market economy under a limited government, and when the time of liberation came at last, the opportunity to rise would be theirs as well. For generations afterward, there was enough opportunity for the poor and the oppressed of many lands to realize their dreams in our land of promise, inspired by the founders' conservative vision of individual freedom, opportunity, accomplishment, and happiness. Never in the history of an economic system under the rule of law have so many been so successful and so prosperous for so long. In America, we understood that we don't need free markets just to create private riches or government largesse, because material possessions can never substitute for meaning and purpose in one's life. But economic freedom means more than wealth. It means achievement. It means productive work. It means savings. It means imagination. And it means enterprise. All of these are entitled to their just reward. When government taxes away the fruits of your work and smothers your imagination with a thick web of rules, they haven't just taken your wealth, they have robbed you of your purpose. They have stolen your right to pursue your dream. Even worse, although the progressive version of government by the rule of regulators claims to cut the rich down to size, it is the poor, those who are struggling at the bottom to better their lives, who are pulled down by such uncompassionate policies. The American idea, this unique idea, unites liberty, law, and the goal of happiness in a bond that cannot and must not be severed. America is unique, being called upon to restore the promise of liberty under the rule of law, a promise that we have even shed blood to defend. So, ladies and gentlemen, tomorrow is another day. And as I look to tomorrow, I see an America with the most competitive, innovative, transparent, competitive financial markets the world has ever known. Tomorrow I see an America where the economic liberties of every citizen are truly respected. Tomorrow I see an America with boundless opportunity and a surging economy for anyone willing to work hard and dream big dreams. To reach that tomorrow, today, we must commit ourselves to nothing less than replacing Dodd-Frank. With this first step, together, we can win back America's promise. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Chairman Hensarling, for those very clear and pertinent points of discussion. Chairman Hensarling has kindly agreed to take a few questions. He has to leave at 3:10, so that's when we will adjourn. But in the meantime, if I can remind you again, if you have a question, tell us your name first, your affiliation, and then ask your question, and we'll keep going till 3:10. I have questions here. Yes, sir. Wait for the microphone here, please. Right here. I'm sorry. Right in front of you. There we go. Thank you.
Should have kept my hand up. So in terms of legislative...
Could you tell us, give us your name and affiliation?
My name is Rob Tricanelli. I'm with Bloomberg, BNA. So in terms of legislative changes, though, Democrats are pretty dug in. Maybe
you think.
What is the legislative way forward for you then, if there's that much opposition from the other side? I mean, is there are there bipartisan talks going on, or is we just at a complete partisan impasse?
Well, I hope not. Particularly when it comes to regulatory relief for community financial institutions, we have attempted to work with Democrats. In fact, I'm proud that our committee has put forth already 24 bills that have passed the floor, many of which are, by definition, modest regulatory relief provisions. Unfortunately, Dodd-Frank, again, appears to be sacred text among some Democrats. I do not believe Barney Frank to be among them. He's indicated a half a dozen different areas where he would amend his own law. There's very little I agree with Elizabeth Warren on, but I believe she thinks that Dodd-Frank hasn't solved too big to fail. So hope springs eternal, but if Democrats are going to decide that Dodd-Frank is a brand to be protected, or a legacy to be secured, notwithstanding the unintended consequences fraught in a 2,300-page bill that forces 400 rules to be promulgated. I don't even think we've quite had two-thirds of the rules finalized as of yet. Then, yes, we'll be somewhat at a loggerheads. Having said that, I'm thoroughly convinced that the left was working on Obamacare before Obama was even born. So this may be a long labor, and I'm a patient man, and even by Washington standards, relatively young.
I think there was another. Did you have another question right next? Did you have a question here? Oh, no. All right, right over here, please.
Cormac Close, ourfuture.org. And my question is, you mentioned that by being declared a significantly important financial institution, you're basically codifying too big to fail. And if this is true, then why is MetLife suing its designation as too big to fail?
Well, you'd have to ask MetLife. I suppose as an insurance company, they don't want to have a bank capital standard imposed upon them. It's a completely different business model. The Fed has absolutely no experience in applying capital standards to an insurance company. So again, you'd have to speak to them. Listen, it's a mixed bag to have the federal bailout imprimatur behind you, but I suspect they don't want those capital standards imposed upon their business. And I'm quite certain asset managers don't either. Again, these are not banks. These are completely different types of financial institutions. And maybe they know what I said in my speech. The federal government doesn't have a particularly good track record in managing risk in the first place.
I'm sorry, right here, please. Yes. This lady in the yellow there. Thank you.
Hi, Elaine Middleman, attorney. And I'm from Indiana, and my family's had interest in a small bank in Indiana for many years. What can the local bankers do if Dodd-Frank is not repealed to ameliorate the problems that you've described that they're facing?
Well, I'm a legislator, not a banker. They have to hold on in hopes that help will get here. The good news is I feel fairly confident there is going to be an election next November. And I believe that now we have 5 years of data and 5 years of an incredibly strong anecdotal evidence that, again, Dodd-Frank is making us less free, less prosperous, and less stable. The data is undeniable at the rate of loss of our community financial institutions. We are losing the relationship banking model in America today. They are losing their competitive advantage. And so when you say, what is it they can do? Well, they can't have their voice heard. The right to petition your government for the redress of grievances, last I looked, is still enshrined in the Constitution. I would continue to have them appeal to some of the more reasonable democratic minds in this city. And believe it or not, I do not consider that to be an oxymoron. But I'm afraid that too many of them are intimidated today by the voices. It's a struggle between the left and the far left, and sometimes the left hand doesn't know what the far left hand is doing, and the far left hand is choking off any reasonable debate about the fate of our community financial institutions, be they bank or credit union. So how they adjust their business model under this regime, I'm not sure I'm qualified to say, but House Republicans are doing everything we can to get help there as soon as possible. And anytime Democrats are willing to work with us, it doesn't matter how modest the regulatory relief is, there's an open door to work with them to try to save these banks and credit unions.
I'm going to call on Mark, then we'll get to you. Thank you. Can we get a microphone up here, please?
Now, before you ask the question, remember I did say nice things about you.
absolutely, this is going to be helpful. First, I want to address the question that was asked about why MetLife and others don't want to be too big to fail, and to remind us all the advantage of being too big to fail is you get to borrow at a lower rate because the debt markets perceive that as such. So if you look at the example of J.P. Morgan, where about 40% of their balance sheet is long-term debt versus MetLife, where about 5% of their balance sheet is long-term debt, as is institutions like PNC, there's really not a too-big-to-fail advantage. And, of course, we run the risk that we are encouraging MetLife to actually become more leveraged. And my question for you is, other than repealing Title II, what would you do to end too-big-to-fail?
Well, I think you can make a case after 08 that capital and liquidity standards were insufficient. I do not think you can make an intellectual case that they were insufficiently complex. And so I think the key, Mark, is to focus on what are those appropriate levels. But as you well know, it's the classic Goldilocks trade-off. If you get the porridge too cold, you have perhaps 2% economic growth, when history tells us we've averaged 3.5, and with the right public policy, we could probably be doing 4.5 to 5. If you get it too hot, then all of a sudden, maybe you're looking at more cascading failures. Again, right now, the danger is that we are allowing credit to be politically allocated in America by federal regulators who were the ones who brought us to the precipice of the crisis in the first place by deciding that historically prudent underwriting standards in real estate should be thrown on the ash heap and that we could live in this bold new world that anybody could own a home. I want anyone to have the opportunity to own a home, but federal policy and federal regulators did nobody any favors by putting them in homes they could not afford to keep. So, number one, I would, again, I don't know if I can get rid of Title I or Title II, probably not in the short term, but I would hope maybe there would be some common ground on trying to work for more simplified capital and leverage ratios based upon historic norms that on the one hand can't be gamed by the participants and on the other hand does not empower federal bureaucrats to be central planners.
Thank you. You've been waiting here and then we'll get to you. Thank you. Wait for the microphone, please.
Thanks. I just wonder...
Will you remind us your name and affiliation, please?
Okay. My name's Li Yang. I've been here for a little bit. Very frequently. I just wonder if congressmen can really do something about our system. Our system, when you say conservative has no heart, liberal has no brain, what I say is that probably the system has neither heart or brain. So I just wonder if you can really fix the system, because when you have a misrepresentation and misinterpretation of the free economy or free enterprise, that just means free for those who can rob other people's resources, including public or individuals or families or businesses. So there's no way to have a good economic development or growth. So unless Department of Justice or Congress...
I think we're going to stop. We'll stop there. Chairman Hensarling, the question is, how do we fix the system?
How many hours do you have?
Well, we have 6 minutes.
Okay. Well, I don't have a short, pithy answer. There's the old adage, if there's fools in office, it is fools that put them there. My experience is that politics is not so much governed by numbers, but governed by intensity. And what it will take is people becoming more aware, more politically active in the system. And part of that is the work of AEI to empower people with knowledge and facts and arguments. I understand that the congressional approval rating stands somewhere between head lice and bubonic plague. I get that. And so people are concerned about the system, as they well should be. But America's polarized at the moment. I think the polling data bears that out, so there shouldn't be a surprise that Congress is polarized as well. Listen, I have very strong thoughts on what's right and wrong in America, but I never let my principles interfere with trying to compromise policies. Again, Jefferson said, the ground of liberty is to be gained in inches. So I'll negotiate in good faith with any Democrat and ask myself the question at the end of the process, is this piece of legislation taking me in a direction I want to go or don't want to go? Is there more good or more bad? So I think it is important, you know, how do we improve the system? The American people have to hold their elected members accountable, but in order to do that, they have to educate themselves about the process, and they have to decide ultimately what values do they believe in. And I still believe the American people believe in the core values of economic liberty. Well, of liberty, period. I mean, it was economic liberty, religious liberty, political liberty that brought people to our shores in the first place. It's bringing them to our shores today. There is something unique about it. I believe in American exceptionalism, but people have to take enough time to understand the policies, hold their members of Congress accountable, and they could start by talking to Democrats about the plight of community banks.
All right, we're going to have a question here, and this is going to be our last question for the day.
Unless it's difficult, then we'll make time for two.
Thank you for that wonderful speech. I was on Senator Dodd's staff during the drafting process. I didn't understand it then, and I'm even more puzzled now.
Well, more importantly, did he understand?
Why could it has to do more with process? But why couldn't the bill be a compromise bill? Why couldn't it have Sarbanes-Oxley was a bipartisan bill? Why didn't Dodd or Frank attract enough thoughtful leaders like you to make it a different product?
Well, you would have to talk to them. I cannot climb inside their innermost thoughts. What obviously suggests itself is that the Democrat Party was enjoying a rare supermajority status in the House and the Senate at the time. And because of that, they did not need a single Republican vote to pass their agenda, and they were not interested in doing something that that the whole of the American people might be able to embrace. I mean, they had a supermajority that a party might enjoy once or twice in a century. I recall the cynical words of now Chicago Mayor Rahm Emanuel, never let a serious crisis go to waste. It allows you to do things that otherwise you could not do. And so a lot of Dodd-Frank was a grab bag wish list from the left that had little or nothing to do with the root causes of the financial crisis. And let us remember, and I'm sure Peter is well aware of this since he was on the commission report that reported on what the root causes of the financial crisis were came out after Dodd-Frank was already passed. So it's kind of like playing basketball and the other team hasn't shown up on the court. You're dribbling and dunking, and they decided to dribble and dunk. And unfortunately, the American people, I think, have again suffered less freedom, less prosperity, and less stability because of it. And my hope still is that in divided government, there will be at least enough Democrats to say, you know, maybe there are ways that we can at least clarify Dodd-Frank. Maybe there are ways that we can improve Dodd-Frank. I'm not going to give up my quest for replacing it, but I can walk and chew gum at the same time, so I can work with Democrats and find common ground and try to keep a few more community financial institutions alive, try to improve our GDP just a little. But anyway, that's a better question for them, and I haven't seen either of them in a while. Anyway, thank you very much for this rare privilege to speak before you.
Thank you very much.
That's great. Thanks for being here.